To get started, what is the node graph? The node graph is another way of viewing and managing your channels, layers, and shaders. You can set up a node graph for ordering different sets of paint and combining effects in a non-destructive manner, so just like layers. But the node graph gives you a clear overview of what is happening, so you can micromanage the various components as individual nodes. It speeds up and removes steps you'd be doing when working with layers in common workflows, for example, creating and building up masks. Repurposing channels, and by using bake points to save computing usage and speed up Mari's performance. Here we have a node graph currently laid out with some basic nodes you'll be using in your projects. We have what we call single nodes. These are what you'll use to create, manipulate, mask, and build up your materials and details. To focus the node graph, we can hit the F key to fill the panel with either the whole tree or a selected node. Around these nodes, we have a backdrop node, which is useful when you're building up your node graph, adding new elements, and want to easily see which nodes are being used for each part of the script. Everything in the backdrop node will be selected and moved as one. We also can add sticky note nodes to our node graph, which we can reference back to, or use to give notes to other artists working on the same project. To organize our node graph, or create a second branch to continue working, we can create a dot. To quickly do this, hold Ctrl down, and you'll see these yellow dots appear on the noodles. If we click on one of these, a dot node will be created at that point, which we can then move. The next section of nodes we have are the channel nodes. The channel node is usually at the end of your node tree where your textures are going to be exported from. It defines the size, bit depth, and view transform of your texture maps. We have four channels created with the shader chosen on project creation. The channel nodes are then connected to the shader node for the corresponding input of that node. The shader node helps Mari to know what to compute when viewing your project and is a way to view multiple texture maps at once. Finally, at the end of the tree, we have the viewer node. This is used to view your textures and we can have multiple inputs into it to then jump between different parts of your node graph. We can use the 0 to 9 key on the keyboard to create another viewer input. The second input will be highlighted, showing us what input the viewer is currently displaying. Within the node graph, there are multiple ways to remove a node or multiple nodes from the tree. One way we could do this is by selecting the nodes we want to remove and shake to extract them from the tree. Or we could hit the Y key to enter sever mode. The cursor will update with a razor tool, and now we can sever the connections between nodes by clicking and dragging across the noodles. Once we have severed the nodes we want, we hit the Y key to exit this mode and continue working. We can change the navigation style of the node graph in Mari's preferences, so if you prefer to work with Nuke's node graph navigation or keep Mari's, you have the choice. We can also disable the shake to extract, or update its preferences to work for you. We're now going to look at how we can do some simple painting with nodes. To create a node, we hit Tab in the node graph, which opens a menu where we can start typing the node we want. Once we start creating nodes, at the top of the list, we'll have the recently used nodes. Below them are nodes we have pinned to the menu as commonly used. To pin a node, we can click the pin icon next to the search bar. This opens the drop-down list with a checkbox next to every node we can create. We can select one or multiple nodes we want to pin. Now when we hit Tab, it will appear in our pinned list of nodes. To get started, we actually want to create a color node. So we type color into the search bar and hit enter. We have now created our first node. We can then plug the color node into our channel node and view our shader. To open a node's properties, we double-click on the node. We now want to pick a color to use as our base for the model, then click OK. You can quickly create the previously created node in the Tab menu by hitting Tab. It will already have color in the search bar, so we hit Enter to create a second version of our node. Selecting it and hitting 2, we can see it on our model, and we can pick a color we want to apply to it. Now using the 1 and 2 key, we can quickly compare the color nodes to each other in the viewer. But to see them together, we're going to need another node. So by hitting Tab, we type in Merge. However, instead of creating a merge through the Tab menu, we can use the shortcut M. We then need to connect our color nodes to the merge. so we connect our base color to the base input and our second color node into the over input. Viewing the merge node, it will now be filled with the color we have in our over input. This is because we need to create a mask to specify where we want that color to be applied. On the merge node, we can set the different merge modes and the amount value of the merge. Hitting tab again, we type paint and enter. This node shortcut key is P. When we create a paint node, we'll get a pop-up window in order to set the node up. Because we want to paint the areas on the model where we want our color to be applied, we set the fill to black. We also want to make sure we set scalar data. You'll use scalar data when needing non-color data, such as creating effects such as bumpiness, roughness, shininess, reflectivity, and as we are here, masks. And hit OK. Now we'll connect the paint node as the mask input to our merge. The model will fill to the color that we set on the base node. We now need to paint the areas white in our paint node where we want our over input to be applied. And we can use the paintbrush tool to paint white on the areas we want. Or we could use selection groups and select the mesh and fill it white. Now we'll have a black and white input to the mask node, and viewing the merge, we can see the two color nodes being applied. We can continue through our node graph, creating merge nodes, color nodes, paint nodes, and build up the base color of our model. Mari ships with a selection of materials on the shelf. We can drag these onto our model or directly into the node graph to create a node for that material. Here we've created a diamond material we want to apply to the crown of our model. When creating materials, we are creating multiple channels, unlike the basic color RGB. We can double click on the node to open its properties and make changes to the knobs to get the look we are wanting. We then can go through the materials in Mari and drag another material from the shelf onto the node graph. This time, to merge our two materials, we can't use a general merge node. As each material node has multiple channels running through it, we'll need to create a multi-channel merge node to keep the stream of channels running through our node graph. When we create the node, we'll be asked what shader model we are wanting to use. Now we can input our base material into the merge and the other into the over input. When we view the multi-channel merge, it will be filled with our over material. Like we did before, we now want to create a paint node, making sure to set it to scalar data to create the mask we want to apply the over material to. We'll then use the paintbrush tool to create a mask for that material and then view the shader. We can make any adjustments to the material knobs as we go along, and we'll repeat this process to merge any other materials into our scene. Now viewing the shader node in the viewer, we have both our materials applied. We'll repeat this process of applying materials. Then by using a backdrop node, we can group and organize the node graph. In Mari, we can create a material node to create our own materials that can then be exported and shared. To open a material node, we hit Ctrl and Enter. This opens a new node graph for our material. We can now add nodes and build up the material we want. On each node, we can expose its knobs to the material node. Back in the main node graph, viewing the material node's properties, we can see these knobs available for us. We can rename the knobs, edit, and add any new knobs to the material itself. This material is now ready to be exported from Mari and shared to other artists. Once exported, we can import this new material into the shelf and add it to our node graph. Mari has two nodes that can be used throughout our script to share sections of nodes from one part of the node graph to another without needing to copy and paste or have multiple noodles crossing each other. We have the teleport broadcast and the teleport receiver. The teleport broadcasting node we can use at the end of a branch after the nodes we want to use somewhere else and throughout our script. By using the broadcast node, we can set up a name for the channel that we'll use later with the receiver node. So for example, we could use a broadcasting node to set up different masks that will be used throughout our scripts. Once we've set the channel name of our broadcast, we are ready to use the teleport receiver node. On the teleport receiver node, under the channel list, we can now see the list of broadcasting nodes that are broadcasting in our script. By using the teleport receiver nodes, we can point them to the same broadcaster to use elsewhere in our script. By using these nodes, if a change needs to be done to one of the broadcasters, we can click Focus Broadcaster on the receiver node and it will jump to that area in my node graph. Once the changes have been made on the broadcast node, I can click Focus Receiver and pick which receiver I want to focus in on, so I can quickly jump between different areas in my node graph by using the Teleport Broadcast and Teleport Receiver. The teleport broadcaster can also be sent into groups and materials within the same project. In the node graph, we can use backdrop nodes to organize the script and group certain nodes together. But we can also group nodes into a single node in the node graph. This means you could organize your script and also export groups of nodes as gizmos. To group nodes, we select the nodes we want to group, hit tab, and type in group, then enter. All the nodes selected will be moved into that group node, and in place we'll have one node. We can always open that group by hitting Ctrl Enter on it, or Ctrl and double click. This will open that group in a new node graph, which we can continue to work on and make changes. Group nodes can have multiple inputs or outputs. Since you decide what's going on inside of the group node, you can also have no inputs at all. We can expose any knobs in the group we want to have quick and easy access to on the group node itself. And once we have the group node set up with the exposed knobs and any other changes we wanted to make, back in the main node graph, viewing that node, we can rename it and rename any knobs which are now available to us. The group node can now be exported from Mari and shared to other artists. We can also convert our group to a custom procedural node if needed. We can export nodes out of the node graph to share with other artists by selecting one or multiple nodes, right-clicking in the node graph, going File and Export Nodes. Now in another project or another artist can input these nodes into their node graph. However, any paint nodes will not contain the paint strokes when created. Or procedural nodes that can be used within the node graph. They allow you to add texture patterns, grid patterns, environments, and masks to your node graph. Here, we have the multiple procedural nodes that come in Mari, which we can create through the tab menu. But as well as the procedural nodes that come with Mari, we can also create our own and share them to other artists. We can do this with the custom procedural node. And the custom procedural node allows you to create textures, which can then be exported as a procedural texture and added to the shelf. The node can be exported as a color procedural, a scalar procedural, or a procedural mask. We can copy and paste nodes between the different node graphs we have in Mari. We can expose any knobs from the nodes inside of the custom procedural that we want available for us in the main node graph on the custom procedural node. Once exported, we can import our new custom procedural onto the shelf and drag it into the node graph to use in other projects or share with other artists. All of those exposed knobs would be available on the custom procedural. As we continue to work in Mari and finish areas of the node graph, we can use bake points to keep and improve Mari's performance. A bake point node is a great way to optimize your scene and keep it running at the working pace. There are two bake point nodes you can use. First, we have the bake point node, which you'll use when working on single channels. When you first create a bake point, you'll be asked to select the settings you want to bake as. Both bake point nodes have three states: grey, the default colour when created and has never been baked; green, when it has finished baking the upstream nodes and we are now viewing the baked result. Once baked, we could add filters which will be applied after the bake of the node from the Filters tab. For example, we could add a blur. And then red. The node will turn this color if we have made changes upstream of the bake point, so it is no longer using the latest data. Something has changed and it needs to be updated. There is also the multi-channel bake point, which you'll use if you're working with materials or of multiple channels upstream you're wanting to bake at the resolution and bit depth we set per channel. When using the multi-channel bake point, we can choose which channels to bake by either selecting Bake Active or Selected. When the bake point turns red, you'll see which channel is out of date in the node properties. Instead of baking all of the channels again, we can pick and choose which channels we want to rebake. In Mari 7.0, we introduced the bakery for baking mesh maps. There are 6 types of bake items we can create and export as paint nodes or geomaps. Once the baking has completed, we can close the window. We will now have the paint nodes in our node graph for each baked item, and we can use them in our script. We have also baked out geomaps, which we can use in the Geo-Channel node. The Geo-Channel gives you the ability to use the same material on a variety of models to achieve the look of edge wear and tear and any other effects on your mesh. By creating a Geo-Channel node and opening its properties, we can see all the baked items in the list of channels we can use. The Geo-Channel can be used more widely across our project than the paint node. For example, we could use the Geo-Channel node as an overall effect to our texture by using an ambient occlusion channel with a levels and merge node. Geo-Channels are object-based image sets that can import in or bake to and use within your materials and node graph. You can also create a bake to Geo-Channel from the bake point node. We can export our Geo-Channel from Mari to use in another project to replicate the same effect. By using a Geo-Channel that will be used in both projects, in a materials node or a custom procedural. Once we have set up our material, we can export that out of Mari, and in a new project, we can import our smart material onto the shelf. We can then drag that material from the shelf onto our node graph and use. It will have any knobs that you had exposed in the original project on our material to use.